Hello, investors, and welcome to my YouTube channel, where I study the best investors and businesses from around the world. Today, we're going to be taking a deep dive into all things Peter Kundil. Peter died in 2011 from a rare neurological disorder, but left behind a philanthropic and investing legacy, as well as a wealth of advice for those of us looking for deep value investments. For the first 10 years of its existence, Kundil's fund returned 26% compound annually. With few down years, he had a track record of outperforming the market and doing exceptionally well when the market was underwhelmed. But we should start with his early life and education. Kundil was born in Quebec in 1938 and received education at both Lower Canada College and later completed his Bachelor's of Commerce degree at McGill University in Montreal. Not much is known about his early years. Still, Christopher Rizzo Gill paints a picture of the complicated man in his biography. There's always something to do. Kundil had a few nomadic tendencies, pulling up roots and moving to various countries when the itch arose, and found a love for long-distance running at a late age. He claimed to run 10 kilometers every morning before work and completed 22 marathons throughout his life. Kundil tended to burn the candle at both ends, having a penchant for alcoholic drinks, often in excess when out in social settings. Kundil was described as having the instincts of a pirate and the skills of a forensic accountant by both the Globe and Mail. His biography describes him as taking very careful, calculated risks. This barely scratches the surface of Peter Kundil's repertoire, so let's take a closer look at his investment style, legacy, and track record. Kundil's investment philosophy was built on Benjamin Graham's net-net value investing. Early in his investment history, he got a crash course in the concept. He was stung by a disastrous mining investment in his early years, and what turned out to be his final interview with the Globe and Mail, he revealed that while studying at McGill University, he bought $500 worth of speculative mining stock. While working a vacation job, he lost everything in less than 48 hours, and he stated that it was an experience he would never forget. This loss shaped his strategy moving forward. He became a strong proponent of the margin of safety as a central tenet of his investment style, always looking for ways to buy a dollar for 40 cents. But what is a net-net stock in layman's terms? It is a stock with a low price to book or P to B ratio. Additionally, the B value has been stripped of all long-term assets. Stripping away long-term assets provides a net current asset value, or NCAV, which gives a highly conservative estimate of the company's liquidation value. Benjamin Graham found often third-party acquisitions of a company were made for a price roughly equaled to the NCAV, making this a valuable way to identify net-net stocks. Kundil didn't think that you had to be a genius to make a solid, profitable investment. While many armchair experts and those with finance degrees mock back-of-the-envelope investing, Kundil said that all you needed was a company's published reports and records that plus a sharp pencil, a pocket calculator, and patience. We're fortunate that our smartphones will check all of these boxes except patience. While our modern world provides mountains of data, Kundil remained focused on the most critical markers, such as how cheap a stock was, rather than a complete industry analysis. Kundil's track record speaks for itself. His fund, the Kundil Value Fund, returned 26% compound annually for the first 10 years of its existence. He consistently outperformed the market with minimal down years, doing exceptionally well when the market was underwhelmed. He pushed investing to its limits with the goal of simplification and reduction. He focused on liquidation value and traditional value metrics. investing against the crowd and looking for bargains in the market's less popular areas brought tremendous opportunities. From downtrodden industries, unpopular stocks, and underperforming markets, a deeply discounted market inevitably meant there were more highly depressed stocks to consider. He once said of this approach that being out on a limb alone and appearing to be wrong is just part of being a value investor. He was passionate about his investment strategy and was not afraid to share it. He famously said, "If it's cheap enough, we don't care what it is," and continued to go against the grain for many of his investments. He explained his investment criteria in a letter to investors after taking over management contract of the All-Canadian Venture Fund, later renamed to the Kundal Value Fund. Kundal's six pillars of investing are, 1, the price of a share must be less than its book value. It should ideally be lower than net working capital minus long-term debt. 2, the price must be less than half of the previous high, ideally at or near the all-time low. 3, the price-to-earnings ratio must be less than 10 or the inverse of the long-term corporate bond rate, whichever is lower. 4, the business has to be profitable. It should have increased its earnings for the previous 5 years and not had any deficits during that time. 5, dividends must be paid by the company. Ideally, the dividend will have been steadily increasing and paid for a long time. 6, long-term debt and bank debt, including off-balance sheet financing, should only be used sparingly. If necessary, there must be a room to increase the debt position. Can you guess which unspoken criteria isn't mentioned here? I mentioned it earlier in the video. Patience. As you might imagine, investments that met all six of these markers were uncommon during Kundal's heyday, and they are even rarer now. Peter Kundal's patience was the secret sauce for his investments. This is attribute 1, which was even higher than the safety margin that he adopted after losing investments early on. Patience leads to courage and conviction when it's time to invest. Since he frequently bucked market trends, these descriptors were synonymous with Kundal. Going against the trends required him to focus on the unique trends to each investment. Once Kundal was satisfied with the financials, he would analyze the burn rate, the rate at which enterprise spends money over income. Looking at this, he would hope to understand if there was a catalyst that caused higher or lower burn rates to protect his margin of safety. In his own words, he lays this out. One of the risks of net-net investing is that if you buy a net-net that starts to lose money, your net-net drops on value, and your chances of making a profit diminish. So the trade isn't so much about predicting earnings as it is about having a firm belief that the company won't go bankrupt and that your margin of safety will be preserved over time. Because finding high-quality companies that met his strict criteria was increasingly difficult to find in North America, he diversified his portfolio, embracing international investing. Of course, as investors, we need to look for great net-nets worldwide. We might not all be able to pick up and travel like Kundal, still, we can quickly determine which markets have been underperforming in a given period. This could be accomplished by comparing stock exchange performance or using Shiller PE ratios. Just like everything in life, follow-through matters. When it comes to investing, that usually means knowing when to sell. Selling is one of the most challenging aspects of value investing and can be the source of much anxiety. The worry about selling too soon, waiting too long to sell, or otherwise timing the market is difficult, if not impossible. Kundal grappled with this early in his career. The timing difficulty in selling is not knowing the trading discount to intrinsic value has been eliminated. He explained, "But judging how much it is likely to be surpassed, Additionally, an increase in the stock price above fair value can add a significant amount of upside to an investment's performance and could be a solid indicator to sell. But doesn't that still require timing the market? Not necessarily. Kundal established a logic-driven mechanism for making these selling decisions. When a stock doubles, sell half. Then you have a free position. Then it turns into a form of art. When you sell is determined by your unique circumstances. Using his method of selling half of a holding when it has doubled means that you will break even at the minimum. Then it's just a matter of using your best judgment to decide when to sell your remaining positions in each stock. I hope Peter's life and investment strategies have been interesting to learn about. If you're interested in learning more, I suggest that you continue learning about him by reading his biography. There's Always Something to Do is the essential book on Kundal. The title alone is an excellent takeaway from Kundal's overall strategies. To find the best deals, we must effectively use the resources at our disposal. As a result, there's always something to do to further your investments. Although net-net stocks may seem like a dying breed, resources such as Value Line or Ticker have proven to be an excellent resource for making investment decisions easier. They provide access to information that eliminates a great deal of Kundal's legwork requirements. Then it's up to us to patiently look for bargains and trust our instincts when we decide to take the plunge and invest in particular stocks. All deep value investors should follow Kundal's mantra of patience, patience, and more patience. As Kundal suggested, think long term and remember that big reward accrue with compound annual rates of return. We should all have this mantra written down and read it back to ourselves before panic selling or in times of doubt. If actions speak louder than words, Kundal's investment record speaks for itself and provides numerous lessons for eager investors. I hope you enjoyed today's video and learned something about net stock investment strategies. Thank you so much for watching, and if you like this video, please share it with your friends and family. It helps the channel a great deal. Leave in the comments section your thoughts about the video and who I should cover next. With that said, thank you guys so much for watching this video, and I'll see you in the next one.